Thank you very much, Joanne. Let's take a look at the Clare team first. This is the Clare goalkeeper, Aver Quilligan. He's from Feakill and won 2 All-Ireland under 21 medals. Under Brian Lohan, he became first choice keeper, lost his place this season, and then won it back for round 2 of the Munster Championship against Limerick. He's definitely going to be tested this afternoon. Unfortunately, Conor Cleary hasn't recovered from a dislocated shoulder he experienced against Cork on May 21st last. His place now goes to Smith O'Brien's Keane Nolan. His cornerbacks will be Adam Hogan and Rory Hayes. John Conlon's transfer from attack to defence in recent years has been a massive success, and he will once again wear the centre-back jersey. His wingmen have been fantastic in this championship, Dermot Ryan and David McInerney. All-Star midfielder 2022, David Fitzgerald from Aineken Limona, has formed a very strong partnership with Colm Malone, and once again their displays in centre field will be crucial. Tony Kelly leads the Banner County attack, and as we all know, when he's on fire, Clare are on fire. Peter Duggan and especially Aidan McCarthy have been outstanding so far. Clooney Quinn's Ryan Taylor can play anywhere, while the other two in the full forward line, Shane O'Donnell and Mark Rogers, are proven match winners and goal scorers, and on any given Saturday evening or Sunday afternoon can be brilliant. And of course their opposition is All-Ireland and Munster champions. 13 years ago, Nicky Quaid made his championship debut as a midfielder for Limerick, but he's now an outstanding goalkeeper, just like his late dad Tommy and cousin Joe, who both wore the number one jersey. I often think Dan Morrissey is an unsung hero at fullback for Limerick. He's been rock solid in the number three jersey, quietly magnificent, and well supported by two great cornerbacks, Mike Casey and Barry Nash. It is undoubtedly one of the greatest half-back lines in the game of hurling, and I don't say that lightly. Dermot Burns, Declan Hannan the captain, and Kyle Hayes. They really are the magnificent three, enough said. One can't say enough about the Limerick centre field. Darragh Donovan and William O'Donoghue have formed a great partnership in the middle of the field that other counties have tried but failed to master. Late change in the half forward line. David Reedy is going to play at centre half forward in place of Carl O'Neill. His two wingmen, Garrod Hegarty and Tom Morrissey, are two of the best in the number 10 and number 12 jerseys. The full forward line for Limerick is quite simply awesome. Aaron Gillan is as cute as a fox, while full forward Seamus Flanagan has scored 4-7 in 4 games. But Peter Casey is out, and his position on top of the left goes to Graham Mulcahy.
Teams and managers to Mackie Stand, please.
Yeah, so quite a few changes. Joe, you were obviously a very experienced top forward in the game. You're getting ready to play in a big final. You find out that it's a young lad, a very well-respected and thought-of young lad, who's coming to mark you on the big day, as is quite likely to happen with Aaron Gillan and Adam Hogan. Would you be relishing that?
It's hard to know. Sometimes you're better off knowing what you're kind of going to be against in one way. When you're marking a new guy, you don't know what way he can be. Like, I think it's even better for Adam Hogan or Keane Noel, whoever's going to pick up Aaron Gillan, that, like, they need to be a little bit worried about him. I think Gillan would have probably favoured probably Conor Cleary in there because he knows him. He's marked him so many times. So sometimes you can be a little bit nervous not knowing who you're going to mark as well at the same time.
They don't know either, Joe. They don't know who
they don't know. No.
We used to know. We'd see the team in the paper. You'd know who you'd be marking. But, like, now you haven't a clue.
Yeah, and on the other side as well, like, you have Graham Mulcahy and David Reedy coming in. It's their first starts this year. I'd say John has put a massive emphasis on, you know, Peter coming off the bench, Colin Neal coming off the bench. So it's a big day for the two of them as well. I know Graham is around a while.
You're forgetting about Keane Lynch, are you?
Keane is still there as well. He's in the back pocket.
He's all right, isn't he? I love how you purposely.
But, like, it's funny. Any other team couldn't afford to leave Keane Lynch out of the team. If it was Tony Kelly the other side, he'd be playing.
Well, it's not a 100% Keane Lynch. I'm sure if he was right at the peak of his powers, there's no chance. That
but the point is, if Tony Kelly was only 50%, he'd be still playing. Keane Lynch is probably 80%.
We'll see. Will Carl Mannion play later on?
when we get to go.
What match is that?
First of all, though, 5 in a row Limerick are going for Shane. That is a massive deal. Does that add massively to the pressure as well?
Yeah, listen, we can see they're going around here in the parade, Joanne. It's absolutely mental out here. We can hardly hear each other up here. There's two words I'm going to say, right? You talk about it, you've got to be process-driven and you've got to be emotionally driven. I definitely think Clare are an emotionally driven county. You know, I can't speak for this dressing room here underneath me, but up the top I can speak for John Kiley. He will have them wound coming out of the dressing room, as will Brian Lohan. I know Dale said it by the warm-up, that whole emotion kind of goes. Limerick are used to these big days. They're so well process-driven that when it comes down to home straight, I would obviously like to think that they're going to have a small bit more experience. It's going to be a savage. The atmosphere is unbelievable and the emotion is off the charts.
Speaking of emotional Clare men, Anthony Daly,
Yeah, Joanne, it's incredible, as Shane has described it well there. And you know, I'd be nearly more concerned with the start for Clare. Like, that full back line without Connor, I'd have gone on record this week saying I felt we were going to win if Cleary's fit. I'm going to stick with my own. I just have great vibes, but I find Kylie, I'm saying get it in often and early, test them early on. So the first 10 minutes for me are nearly, I'll worry about the end of it. We've Aaron Shanahar, we've Ian Galvin, Paul Flanagan, Shane Amori to come in as well. So the start for me is everything.
And of course, there was that brilliant clip going around online of the first 39 seconds of last year where there were just hits going in all over the place. Are we expecting something similar like that? And Joe, which way is the neutral verdict going, and will it be in 70 minutes?
Penalties for me. Oh! I wouldn't be one bit surprised if it ended up in penalties here today. It'd be some crack, wouldn't it?
We missed the Leinster final, though.
Huh?
Well, we'll get to that in a little while. To talk to us, Pat Ferry, August Gary McDonagh, La Fall Air, RT News Channel, RT Player, August Air, Serfview HD. But our commentary team here for this brilliant Munster Hurling final of 2023 at the Gaelic Grounds, Brendan and Marty.
Thank you very much, Joanne. Well, if Hollywood Steven Spielberg or our very own Jim Sheridan or Martin McDonagh was making a blockbuster movie about hurling and the special competition that is the Munster Hurling Championship, they really couldn't have scripted, produced or directed a more exhilarating, more dramatic storyline than what we've all experienced and enjoyed since the opening credits began on April 23rd last. Just 7 weeks ago. 7 weeks of an adrenaline rush of excitement beyond our wildest hopes as every game was scintillating and frenetic as the five counties in the Munster Championship battled it out for this day. Have a look around. It's a sellout. Tickets have been impossible to get. There's no room, no space available in the Gaelic grounds here in Limerick on this day, June 11th, 2023. Who will ever forget last year's Munster final? Gerard Hegarty's brilliant goal. Tony Kelly's sensational sideline cut equaliser. The extra time. This year on April 29th, just 6 weeks and one day ago, Clare and Limerick again served up an incredible game of hurling in this very arena. Again, it was a sellout. The Banner County this time won by a point. So don't expect this to be easy on your nerves. It's Limerick against Clare. And to be honest, I said in the piece that you might have seen earlier, I've stood on Jones's Road and on All-Ireland final day, but nothing compares to a Clare Limerick Munster Hurling final day. Brendan Cummins.
It doesn't matter, it's just coming down the long end with mingling with the supporters, an hour and a half, 2 hours before the game, the place is black around. And look, there's no doubt anticipation is high here. Agree to the lads in the studio, that Clare team below, staying in the parade, staying in their focus. This is what we said we were going to do. Don't worry about the opposition, we'll do our own thing today. Kind of a statement, that's what they have to do. The first 10 minutes here, Marty, are going to be absolutely key. And when Nolan is tested inside in the full back line or wherever he is around the pitch, if he wins the first ball, the banner roar will go out of the stadium here and Clare might be on their way. But it's going to take a little bit of luck, I think, for one of these teams below us to jump the fence, but it's going to be some game.
There is an incredible bond between Clare and Limerick people, between the neighbours, like a love of Munster rugby and Thomond Park that I can see in the distance. So many employees at Shannon Airport from Clare and Limerick sing songs at Dirty Nellies, Wild Nights in Partine, love marriages. These neighbouring counties have it all. But for the next 70 minutes, everything is forgotten about. It's the most important issue sorted out, the Munster Hurling title. It's going to be a pause here for a moment for the late Teddy McCarthy, who died during the week. An incredible player who won two All-Ireland medals hurling, two All-Ireland medals football, Texaco Football of the Year 1989. And of course, will always be remembered for being the only player to win All-Ireland medals within 2 weeks of each other. September 1990, when Cork won the All-Ireland hurling title beating Galway and the All-Ireland football title beating Meath. We pass on our deepest sympathies to his wife Una, daughter Sinead, sons Cian and Niall, and everybody here, much loved, much admired, Teddy McCarthy, whether we're from Cork or from any other part of the country. We pass on our deepest sympathies. And now here on this very special day in the province of Munster, St. Patrick's Pipe Band Tulla will play our national anthem, Aron na Bhfíal. To the roar. It's the 60th championship match between the neighbours. Limerick have won 37, Clare 20 with two draws. Match referee is Liam Gordon from County Galway. In his very first Munster hurling title, we wish him well. Limerick won the toss, playing from right to left. This is about pride. This is about bragging rights. Who's it going to be? Clare Limerick. Away we go. The 2023 Munster hurling final. Colin Malone sending it up to Limerick. Side of the field initially.
The space.
Ball dropped down into that full forward line. Aaron Gallan getting his first touch. Nice turn. And that is just to the wrong side of the post.
Already as Keane Nolan and Rory Hayes are inside on Gallan and Flanagan. About 60 yards of space in front of both of them. The normal cornerback in your club's eyes would be watering. They see that, but those two men in there have to try to hold their own. Clare left off the hook slightly there.
Long took out from Aver Quilligan. Shane O'Donnell going for it. Linesman says it's going to be a clear ball. Mark Rogers is coming across to take it. Scored a sideline actually in that round robin championship match against Limerick. It was a little bit closer if I remember correctly. Cuts it in well, aiming for Peter Duggan. He gets a hand to it. Knocked away, comes first Dermot Burns. Needs to pull it quickly out first. Garrod Hegarty goes long. David Reedy chasing this. Staying with him is Paul Malone. Clare win the ball back into the centre. Adam Hogan playing in his first Munster final. Going a hearty cup, of course, with that great win, St. Joseph's Tulla. Mark Rogers. The hits are already going in. Clare hoping to open their account. Shane O'Donnell has the overlap, pass inside off. Beautiful Dermot Burns. Lovely interception, kept his eye on the ball all the time. And he's there to sweep it up, vacuum up any danger. Comes first that 20 metre line, sends it down the middle towards David Reedy. Dermot Ryan is with him. Nice ball, good vision. Over for his Tom Morrissey. Is this the first score? The Limerick fans like it. Yep. They love it more when the flag goes up to indicate the first score of the game.
They do, and it was David Reedy was the out ball. See a flick on there from Burns. Great ambition from Clare, Marty, it has to be said there. There was an easy point on, but they decided they were going for a goal. In fairness to Burns, he got the flick away. Two simple passes into that man's hands, and steady and score now for Limerick. Interestingly as well, inside, Tony Kelly and Duggan are gone inside as the two for Clare.
Aver Quilligan going long again, aiming for Peter Duggan, doing a Limerick trick in it as such. Nicky Quaid. He's been aiming for Garrod Hegarty for many seasons. It's worked beautifully for them. Clare trying to do something similar with that long tuck down towards Peter Duggan. John Conlon is there. Has the time to compose himself. Send it out to the wing. Limerick attack. Good work by Kyle Hayes. Never wait for the ball. We're all taught it at under-12s and under-14s. Kyle Hayes learned that when he was a young boy in his parish. Go for it.
That he did, and John Conlon is sitting back there now, so the first 30 seconds or so is just them finding their feet. You see Kyle Hayes nipping in there, really expecting to get that in his hand, but in fairness to him, Ryan did really well to get back and get a flick on it.
Oh, Rory Hayes, from the same club as his manager Brian Lohan, just down the road at Wolf Tones na Shannon, Shannon Airport. John Conlon aiming possibly for Tony Kelly, trying to scoop it up. Dan Morrissey is there, giving it out. There's Kyle Hayes. He pulls the brakes. Three of them are trying to stop him. In nips William O'Donoghue. Plenty of Limerick options across that 45-metre line. The captain, Declan Hannon, is one of them. He drops it in long. It's two against two. It's the touch. Is the Limerick man being fouled? I think he is. And the referee agrees. It's a free in for Limerick. And Seamus Flanagan was clearly being held.
He was. Just before the ball came in, the two of them had a great wrestling match there as well. But in fairness to Rory Hayes, Flanagan, once he gets a goal side of the ball like that, he's very, very hard to deal with. And nearly as a defender, you're saying, OK, you can have a point here and we'd all move on. One-on-one like that, if he got around and spun him, he was straight in at Eber Quilligan.
Aaron Gallan going to take this. Big day for the Galway official. Aaron Gallan has scored 25 points in four games in the championship. This is a simple top over for him. And the Munster and All-Ireland champions have settled well with two early scores.
They have, and Tony Kelly has come out from inside the 21 of Limerick, out around the 45 now, or 65 of Limerick, just to try to get into the game. See, David Reid, he's got a nice bit of possession there. Clare would be hoping Tony Kelly could do the same.
John Conlon and Cian Nolan were making themselves available for a short puck out, but again they go long. Shane O'Donnell somehow managed to get it up into the hand. Referee has blown his whistle and he's given a free to Clare.
It's been a big feature of Shane O'Donnell coming out around the half forward line in the last number of years, is that his ambition to attack defenders there. See Burns and Casey, knowing that they got inside Tony Kelly, had actually broken the line.
Aidan McCarthy. There's his club hurling with Aina Kilnamona. His club football with Kilmurry Arbricket. He scored a goal at 23 points in the journey so far. He's been playing well after a horrific injury at work. Taps that over the bar. Clare are up and running. Took 5 minutes, almost 6 minutes. But that will settle them, Brendan. Took out is a long one by Nicky Quaid. Breaking ball picked up by Tom Morrissey. He's Kyle Hayes available. He's Darragh Donovan available. Just bounced off his chest, being pursued by Malone into the centre. Barry Nash, sweet hurler, wing forward, corner back, down to Seamus Flanagan. Limerick looking for a free. Referee didn't even acknowledge it. Long ball inside towards Mark Rogers. Wonder if it's given with UL. Sideline ball went off his hurling. That sideline is going to be for Limerick.
In fairness, the question before the game, Marty, really around the ref, what's Liam Jordan going to do? He's letting it play, he's letting it flow, he's letting them have contact with each other, which you saw there.
Barry Nash going to take this. Won his first All-Star back in 2021. Little touch on by Graham Mulcahy. Great wrist work, just knocking it back. 24 Mulcahy, 26 David Reedy, 13 Aaron Gallagher. Nice combination. 10 is Gerald Hegarty. He's on the 13-metre line. And that is just gone to the left and wide for Limerick's second wide of the match. I know it's early days, but the tension is palpable here at the Gaelic grounds. Long ball dropping in. The referee spotted the foul by the Limerick defence. Jersey pulling indicated. There it is. It's a free. It's an easy free to give away now.
Yeah, it's on Duggan's left shoulder there. Once he got inside again there, Morrissey was just gave him that little bit of tug. In fairness to Liam Gordon, he spotted it that time. There'll be a bit of that off the ball, Marty. Obviously today there will be pulling and dragging, and as much as the referee can advise in the back of the head, I think if Liam Gordon sees any of those, he will blow him.
On the goal line, Nicky Quaid and his defensive line. On the 20-metre line inside the D, there you have it, Aidan McCarthy. Simple tap over point for him. Sides level for the first time.
A
Nicky Quaid again aiming for this man, Gerard Hegarty, in the centre. William O'Donoghue under pressure from Ryan Taylor, aimed at number 13, but he plays outfield normally. Working hard is Colin Malone, taking the hits, laying it off, all fair and square. Good work by Clare. Ryan Taylor on to Shane O'Donnell, heading towards the 45. Little chink to the right, then swings to the left, and that is over the bar. Great play, Shane O'Donnell. Hard work by Colin Malone. He did the grafting for him. But here rolls Shane O'Donnell. Brilliant.
It is great work to take Will O'Donoghue off the ball. You expect him to break through a couple of tackles. Clare centre defence stopped him, turned it over. And the Shane O'Donnell jink got in the room. His puck out is a problem too for Clare. They've got him coming out this side and turned it.
Clare finding their mojo. Dermot Ryan scored the winner the last time round. He's going for this one, but it's just outside the post for Clare's first wide of the match. Nicky Quaid again aiming for Gerard Hegarty, batting with David McInerney. Little chip up, second time round does the trick. Has the support if needed, and he does, of Adam Hogan. Lets back the shoulders, breathes in the oxygen, lets fly, hits the slither, dropping in towards Nicky Quaid, sending it down towards David Reedy, unmarked momentarily. Backfires Kyle Hayes. It's all go at the Gaelic grounds, as we anticipated. John Connan just couldn't reach it. He's there now. There's a collision, and the referee, I think, I can hardly hear to be honest with you, but I think he acknowledges that was an accidental collision, and he has blown his whistle.
It was accidental there. Both players had their eye on the ball. Obviously, Marty, in a game like this, they're not going, no one's going to stop. Two of them looking at it there and just clashed into each other. Hopefully, John Conlon's all right. He looks the most shook of both parties. Just winded, I would expect.
And we all remember when John Conlon was unable to play against Kilkenny in the All-Ireland semi-final last year. It really upset the balance and the rhythm. And to be honest with you, Clare never recovered from losing their All-Star from 2018. Brian Lohan will be concerned about his centre-half back from Clonlara. Full credit to Brian Lohan. He's really done in his 4 years a great job with this Clare hurling team.
He has, and he sprinkled consistency across all they're doing. It's no accident they've been the ones that have been closest to Limerick over the last number of years.
And the referee has actually given the free.
He gave an indirect Clare free, I think, because Clare would have had possession. So because of that, it's an indirect free now for the Quilligan out.
Dropping on the edge of the D. Royal Peter Duggan, great hands. They play handball down in Clooney. Quinn and Kilkitchen needed that skill there. Giving it out for Ryan Taylor. Turning, making room, uses the short grip. It looks like it's on its way. Oh, beautifully, beautifully judged. Ryan Taylor gets his first point in the Munster final. Look at this for skill. The wrist work, the balance, uses the short grip so he couldn't be hooked. Ball comes down for Aaron Gallagher. Looking at the post. Normal service surely has resumed with Aaron Gallagher. Second point of the game.
It has, and that space, 40 yards outside Gallagher or outside Flanagan. This time he makes hay with it. And in fairness to Keane Nolan, there's not much he can do. Just make sure it's just a point is all that's conceded. He'd normally be expecting one of his wing backs to come back and cut him out.
Target is Carl Malone. Line ball going towards Clare this time. Peter Duggan spent a little time in Australia a few years ago and was welcomed back, of course, to the fold when he arrived. Tony Kelly going to take this. 2 goals and 22 points. 8 of those from frees, and of course a penalty in the 65. This time he goes a little bit short, willing to take on. 5 passing. Dermot Burns heading towards the 20. Umpire going for the flag. Tony Kelly is up and running. And that is an ominous sign if you happen to be from Limerick.
It is. He hadn't really been on the ball in the first 13 minutes or so. Then he chips a soft ball to Duggan. Dances down the sideline, hits it with no marking. It's the quality of him.
Good hands, Aaron Gallagher. Keane Nolan struggling.
This is
Gallan.
Yeah, that's his superpower, Marty, to be honest with you. And the ball bounces like that. He goes to the hand, normally inside a forward, wants to go to Hurley there. But Gallan is such, makes him so dangerous if you're marking him. Once he gets that yard ahead, he goes to the hand and it sticks more often than not. Interestingly as well, it's Dermot Burns who's taken the free from between the 45 and 65. Normally he's some 100 yards out. Obviously, Aaron Gallan has decided that Jim would be the man. He's staying away from the freeze. These ones anyway.
Getting a rub of the towel, as I can assure you it's very warm here in Limerick on this beautiful June Sunday. Dermot Burns hits it, but yeah, didn't quite connect.
It's harder, Marty, when you hit freeze from 50 yards, 60 yards, you're used to hitting from 100. You don't know, do you lash him over the bar? He tried to nurse that one over and just pulled it left.
Again, Aver Quilligan goes long. Kept a hand underneath it. Here comes Peter Duggan, trying to knock it back. Stalemate. Nicely picked up by Carl Malone. Giving it back to Dylan Ryan. Oh, my word. What a score. He's been doing it all summer long. All the way from Cranklow, up 4 or 5 miles down the road.
Some score, he missed one earlier, but it shows the form the man is in. Says I can still have a go, backed himself, great score.
His brother Connor, of course, was man of the match in the All-Ireland final 10 years ago. That's Connor Ryan. His younger brother is certainly following in his footsteps with a score like that.
Yeah, really did really well there on that puck out, Marty's, and went to the far side of the pitch. You watch him slowing down here, he can see Condon coming, just pulls on the brakes. John Condon piles into the back of him. Just that bit of cuteness, I suppose. He gave a little look over his right shoulder.
Aaron Gallan has come back to take this. Made his debut against Clare actually back in 2017. He's won a few All-Stars since. Just outside the 45. There you go. That's the angle. Never in any doubt. Third point of the match for the Patrick Swell club man. 2 point game with all 16 minutes gone. Tony Kelly surrounded, no free. Clare crowd were looking for it. Play on. Now the free is on Dermot Ryan. I think, to be fair to the referee, I think he was watching to see what would happen, because he did put the whistle up to his lips.
He did, and it's the way our game, I suppose, has gone is just in that 10 seconds there, where it's body on body. It looked like a shoulder hit on Kelly. Play on, no free, and then it's just an arm over the shoulder that Tom Morrissey, I think, put in there, and it gives a free. Look,
a little bit further out, a bigger challenge for Aidan McCarthy. Long way from the Limerick City goalposts. Too much of a challenge, just to the right and wide. Second wide of the match for the Banner County. They've come in their thousands, the people of Clare. Just down the road. Short ball, fires Barry Nash, David Reedy. John Condon with it, Barry Nash on the return. South Liberty's man into the space. Good ball for a forward, but well won this time by Keane Nolan. He has the slither in the hand, gives it to Malone, trying to stay within the white lines. Gives it back for his Keane Nolan. And Smith O'Brien's club in Killaloe, a club that produced the late great Axel Foley and Keith Woods and so many stars. Giving it long, dropping it in towards Peter Duggan. Was he being held? The referee concurs.
He was. Duggan rolled Casey Lovely there. Casey, in fairness, had to grab just above the tongs to hold him back. There's the referee, spotted a great ball in. They know the matchup inside here is Duggan. Casey's going to struggle. Casey's left hand there. He just had a little tug on Duggan's jersey. Yellow card as well. The last thing you need, 17 minutes in.
Yellow card for the cornerback. Couldn't appear shake. Be disappointed to be shown a yellow card for that particular soft enough challenge,
yeah,
to be fair,
so.
Brendan.
It didn't strike me as a yellow card there.
No, I didn't think so.
It was a goal scoring try, it'd be a black card, but look, it's a harsh enough one.
Aidan McCarthy going for his third point. confidence restored. Service, normal service restored. 18 and a half minutes gone. Clare, the challengers, leading by three. Tom Morrissey waiting for the break. And it came his way. Graham Mulcahy surely held. The referee agrees, and that is a free for Limerick.
Set puck out for Limerick as well. High and Tonka Heverty breaks it down, and then Morrissey gets and gives it over here to Graham Mulcahy.
In one way, Brendan, both teams are giving away soft enough frees. I mean, Mike Casey's free, Dermot Ryan's free.
Yeah, you're better off maybe going with your body, because very much you're going with the hand and you're behind the toe. Referee seems to be very hot on that, but if you can get body on body, it seems to be the way of play on.
Aaron Gillan concentrating on the challenge ahead. And successful as normal. Aver Quilligan goes long, aiming for Peter Duggan down the middle. Dan Morrissey is there, slipping as the fullback from Aha. Getting the ball out just a little bit. Darragh Donovan receiving the pass from William O'Donoghue. Gives it back in turn towards Casey. Barry Nash. Intercepted, just getting a touch, was Ryan Taylor. Picked up by Dermot Burns. Play on, says the referee. No foul given. Sent forward. Over towards Darragh Donovan. His feet are almost on the sideline. And he's still going for it. And he's got it. Brilliant play, Darragh Donovan. From Doon in County Limerick. An exception. Look where he is.
Yeah, it's an unbelievable score. The player right out on the sideline.
Ball down towards Shane O'Donnell. Kyle Hayes pulling on it. It was fair game. The ball was loose. The Morrissey brothers combine. Tom to Dan. Back in more for military wing back. Aver Quilligan has to come off his goal line. Aver Quilligan is tripped, and that's going to be a free out for Clare.
Yeah, the normal wrestling match we saw against Cork with Gillan inside is happening again, but in fairness to the Clare defender in there, Keane Nolan's doing really, really well.
Free is quickly taken. David McInerney. Adam Hogan. Back to McInerney again. He did well to control it. Needs a bit of support. Pulled on first time. Ball given away. Good work by Limerick. Kyle Hayes. Unmarked. The road Hegarty. Not a good thing from a Clare perspective. Pucks inside. Shoots and scores. Brilliant play, the road Hegarty. But he was given a lot of space, I have to say. But he gets his first point in the Munster final.
He got quick puck out.
Sides level for the second time. No time for Brendan Cummins to speak. As that ball is sent in and sent over the bar. Yes. Now that's a response by Colin Malone.
It is. It's a gamer counter-attack. And so if we're watching here, Marky, both goalies are cute as foxes. As soon as they see they have an opportunity, it just goes straight away, like here again.
Ball sent down towards Big William. To Big Garold. Hegarty. Giving it back. Met his dad actually outside. What a great hurler his dad was as well. Kyle Hayes. Heading towards the 45. We've seen this so many times. Putting it in. Half blocked. Good work by Dermot Ryan. And sent out in turn. Farris David Fitzgerald. Skipping by his own 45. Plenty of Clare players looking for the pass. He goes long towards Peter Duggan, trying to get in. Nicky Quaid comes out with the ball. Good work by the keeper. Farris Dan Morrissey. In control. Sending it down towards Dermot Burns. The play opening up into the centre towards William O'Donoghue. He's on his own 65. He drops it into the space again towards Aaron Gillan. Gillan slither on the hurling, turns, given the space, given the time. This man can inflict serious damage to opposition, but not on this occasion. He normally is just outstanding. Puck out is quickly taken again. Did it go out over the sideline? Linesman says no. Limerick supporters were looking for it. Rory Hayes did well to collect it. Two against one here. Trying to chip it up. Pushed away by Declan Hannon. Fairly, squarely. Good work there by Kyle Hayes. Clare fouled it. Limerick free.
Aidan McCarthy wanted to just get over it. There's no place to be flicking it up like that, especially with Hannon or Hayes floating around you to just nudge you out of the way. There's the pullback.
Free is quickly taken again by Barry Nash. Over towards Dermot Burns. Down the wing. Towards Tom Morrison. Was that a push in the back? I would have thought so. Dermot Ryan. Referee said play on.
Body on body, Marty. You'll get away with that, seems here today.
Ryan Taylor is waiting for it. Mark Rogers is on the run. He takes the ball. He sends it over the bar. The people of Scariff, the people of Clare will be celebrating at one of their best up-and-coming stars. Is a star now. It's Mark Rogers.
So sharp to be out in front of Nash like that, just over the shoulder without a thought.
Nicky Quaid again aiming for Garrod Hegarty. John Conlon underneath it. Lovely stick work by Graham Mackay. John Conlon again coming in to converge to help out Adam Hogan. Paul Malone arrives. They're bobbling there just a few metres in from the sideline. John Conlon putting his hurley in. The referee says, OK, enough is enough. There's going to be a throw ball here. Just a few metres in from the sideline, as you can see. William Gordon bringing it forward just a little bit. Game played in a very sporting manner, despite all the hype and the tension. It's all hands on deck, but being played in a very positive way so far. Referee is giving the free and giving it to Clare.
Yes, I think it's Tony Kelly's second touch there after the point. And he gets it here. You can see the drag back is what the referee blew Darrow Dungan for. And again, Tony has decided to hit this from inside his own 45. It's a long ways back.
Three times an All-Star, 2019, 20 and 22. He's going for the point. He's dropping to the right. And it's gone wide.
Yeah, he's trying to get in the game, I think, Marty, by going back that far. He hasn't really been in it. He's shown, but they can't really get the ball to him. A bit too far out for Tony's range.
Nicky Quaid again, aiming for Garrod Hegarty. David Fitzgerald intervenes. Lovely hook by Graham Mulcahy. Fitzgerald there battling. Barely keeping it in. His body is outside the line, but the ball is not. Shane O'Donnell gets the pass. Says thank you very much, David. Goes towards the Limerick goalpost. Intercepted beautifully. Ball comes back towards Clare again. Good work on this occasion by Tony Kelly. Sent in by David McInerney. And Nicky Quaid has all the time in the world to deliver a pass. Goes long. This time it's Tom Morrissey that he's aiming for, but David McInerney kept his eye on it, squeezes the ball out, sends it back for us. Paul Malone, Barry Nash. It's swinging from end to end, non-stop. Down for us, Kyle Hayes, looking for the pass. It's Darrow Donovan. Kyle Hayes is coming for the return, but O'Donovan goes long. Two against two. Seamus Flanagan, Aaron Gillan, Keane Nolan, Killaloo against Patrick Swell. Beautiful stick work again by Aaron Gillan. He makes an angle for himself and he sends that high up. Fantastic! Really outstanding player by Aaron Gillan.
Well, he's the best in the business, Mark. You can see him here. He's just tracking, tracking. Keane, you could say, should get closer to him, I suppose. You're never that comfortable with Gillan, giving him that much space to have a couple of looks at the target. He didn't disappoint the Limerick supporters and he got to swing the hurley.
Long puck out again. This time caught by Darrow Donovan. Francis with midfield partner. Good work by Tony Kelly. He wants to get involved. This is an opportunity. And it's straight between the posts and over the bar. Much better, Tony Kelly.
Yeah, did all the hard work himself, taking it off. Well done like that. Cutting down the middle, he'll feel way, way better about himself, Marty, after that. Had to earn it himself. Great score.
Hurler of the Year 2013. Young Hurler of the Year as well. Tony Kelly, Mike Casey, bypassing Peter Duggan, heading towards the Clare 45, drops it in towards Aaron Gillan, is causing Clare serious problems. This time, Ken Nolan is close, but he crosses the line.
It's a real nice edge.
Forwards.
It's a real knife edge in there, Marty. The amount of space that Flanagan and Galan have inside there. If you go tight, and now Nolan is about to be booked. That time Galan let him come close, rolled him with the hurley, spun him around. So it's an onus on the fries out the field, I said before the game, to try to stop the ball from coming in. See, holding Galan's left hand there. Galan knows he's in control of that situation there with the hurl in his right. And he spun around lovely. And there's the Nolan, he had to give him that tug back.
Keane Nolan hasn't played in any games in the championship. He is a surprise selection by Brian Lohan, considering Conor Cleary was unavailable. Word was that Paul Flanagan might be brought in, but there's no doubt that Clare have a problem here. They can't cope with Aaron Galan in these opening half hour.
Finish to Nolan too, as Galan should slot this one over the bar. It's up to his teammates as well to try to give him a bit of support. It's not just down to the fact he's not able to do the job, he just needs more support in there while he's doing it, Marty.
6 points for Aaron Galan, still 1 point between the teams. Aver Quilligan has three options, but he's intending to go long nearly every occasion, dropping it down the middle towards Tony Kelly, battered away by Kyle Hayes. In comes Tom Murray, oh, lovely handball, back towards Hayes, creating the space, creating the opportunity. And Kyle Hayes, is he going to avail of it? Oh, brilliant, brilliant, created by the hand pass, the slickness of the speed of this, beautiful. Kyle Hayes on the run, looked at the post, sent it straight between them.
Yeah, just ease through the ball as he struck, which is Morrissey's pass, obviously, the quick chinking. Hayes is ponying up the field a fair bit now as well, Marty, in the last 10 minutes or so.
This time, Aver Quilligan goes reasonably short, I'd say, versus John Conlon. Tony Kelly comes looking for it. Graham Mulcahy was coming in to challenge. Tony Kelly goes for the score, back off the post. Grab, opportunity, goal for Clare! Finish by Mark Rogers, and Clare in the crowd have gone mad. The long ball from Tony Kelly hit off the post. We saw Damien Comer do it for a goal by footballers against Roscommon. We now see Mark Rogers doing it for Clare hurlers against Limerick.
Yeah, we said a bit of luck there, Marty, could separate the teams. It also came off Morrissey's hurley, I think, which put it in over the goalie's right shoulder rather than the left. You see a little block off it, but Rogers, in fairness to him, he spun around and hit it as hard as he could. Finds the back of the Limerick net, a huge fill-up for the banner now.
The first green flag of the Munster Final 2023. Shane O'Donnell, far as Aidan McCarthy, stepping into the middle of the field and grabbing the opportunity. Is there anybody back at home in Clare? The roar is deafening beyond belief. 4 points for Aidan McCarthy in this Munster Final.
Yeah, he's on great space, you can see him there, he knows it's one thing getting the goal, the important thing is that you win the next puck out, stop Limerick from getting a response, and in fairness to Clare, they've done that.
Long ball, Jim McRae beating Tom Morrissey, and they're piling on the pressure. He lays back the shoulders, he's going for it, but it's gone to the left and wide. Four wides for Clare in this match, but they have managed in the opening 32 minutes to score a goal and 11 points. Puck out is varied, coming forward at pace. John Conlon stepping inside into the Limerick half of the field, dropping in towards Peter Duggan, and Nicky Quaid had to be alerted, his near post. Amazing what a goal can do psychologically for a team, or indeed to concede it. David Fitzgerald, double, treble marked, good work by Dara Donovan, scoops it away for Seamus Flanagan. Flanagan in turn lays it off, coming forward from right half back is Dermot Burns. Burns between the 45 and 65. He's looking good. It's not good enough though. Ball is wide. Fifth wide of the game for the All-Ireland and Munster champions.
Yeah, normally the response is that man, your shot just puts it over the bar and saunters back. But they're in a bit of a storm here now at the moment, Limerick.
Again, Aver Quilligan aims, this time for Aidan McCarthy. Knocked away by Declan Hannon. Picked up by Paul Malone. Survives the initial challenge from David Reedy. Gone forward is Ryan Taylor, looking at options. He's going to go for the point. He uses a short grip, but it went outside the post, and that was an opportunity for the Banner County, which went astray. Huge disappointment in size around the Gaelic grounds. Long ball again. Milan and Seamus Flanagan are the targets. Aver Quilligan stood his ground. Steps away from Graham Mulcahy. Good vision. Gets it first, David McInerney. The Tullerman sends it down the middle. Limerick will look to be a little bit exposed here. Ryan Taylor missed an opportunity a moment ago. Mark Rogers is to his right. He'll go for it. Mark my words, and Nicky Quaid had to be there. Great save by the keeper. Batted down far as Nicky Quaid again. It really is pulsating, as it normally is between Clare and Limerick. It's swinging from one end to the other. Jerome Hegarty and Dermot Ryan, the two big men, 6'5", 6'6", they're on the ground. And it's Dermot Ryan that's on the ground. Jerome Hegarty hasn't heard the whistle. The referee has given a free half a mile down the road.
Limerick supporters won't be happy on that one. I'd say he thought that Hegarty had maybe over-carried, and that's why he was given the free. There's a bit of a tussle inside there anyway as well, but it'll be a free in to Limerick.
Little bit of afters, but to be fair, the other players got involved quickly and they were actually pulling them apart rather than getting involved, to their great credit. Liam Gordon and, of course, Garrod Hegarty have met before in the Munster Championship campaign.
Just explained to Garrod there as to why he pulled back the free. You see it here when Hegarty gets inside, there's the initial free, and it was just steps then, I would think, after that, but you're in the stand from Limerick, you're wondering why the advantage wasn't played longer.
Liam Gordon is going in to have a word with his umpires. Meanwhile, Aaron Gillan is putting the slither on the ground. And I have to say, in the first half, I thought Liam Gordon has done well as the referee, Brendan.
Yeah, look, he's, in fairness to him, he's done fine. He's let the game flow. Anybody putting an arm in over the top or a tug of the jersey, but he's seen it, he's blown it, and he's allowed the physical contest that we would expect in a game of hurling as well. It all depends on what his umpires have seen here, maybe, that's caused Adam Hogan to be on the deck.
He possibly could have given Garrod an advantage there, to be fair now.
Yeah, that is the thing, all right. Once he broke inside, a man like Garrod Hegarty, you'd like to see him given the advantage. But maybe he thought it was steps, and then he turned it back, is the only reason I can see for him pulling the free back, that Aaron Gillan has an opportunity now.
Free going to be taken by Aaron Gillan. Gone into injury time. And Liam Gordon is actually looking for Garrod Hegarty. And they have a history, they met before in the Limerick Waterford game.
I'd be interested to see now if he's going to book Garrod Hegarty for something that happened inside on the Clare 21. Is he going to turn the free over and throw in the ball? Would be the question.
Well, he's giving him a detailed explanation. He's giving him a yellow card. Coming in at 36
see it here
minutes.
Now.
I don't think there was anything in
there. There wasn't a huge amount in it either way now. The Clare defenders, as you'd expect, for saying to Garrod how you didn't get in for a goal. He was claiming that I was pulled back too soon. It's harsh enough yellow there, I think.
I would agree. As Aaron Gillan sends that over the bar for his 7th point of the game. I think, Garrod Hegarty was getting a rough time from the Clare backs there, but he was picked out as the
Here's
one.
Here's the goal opportunity then. Yeah, exactly, he was. But for them, for that minute or two here, we see the goal chance. That Limerick defence was wide open now. And seldom you get a shot planting your feet on Nicky Quaid, but he did really, really well to get down to save it.
Good work by Dan Morrissey. Flicking it on towards Kyle Hayes. Shoves off the shoulder of David Fitzgerald, yeah. But he takes too many steps. Free to Clare.
Adam Hogan, Peter Duggan, you name it. Shane O'Donnell, Fitzgerald, all around the ball carrier, all trying to turn him over. It's moments like that as well when you're down there, Marty. It gives you a huge lift when you can get someone like Kyle Hayes to overcarry like that.
Aidan McCarthy has come out to take this free. He's inside his own 65-metre line, as you can see from that camera angle. This to give Clare a 4-point advantage going in at the break, surely. Hits it well. Dropping in, and dropping to the wrong side of the post.
I wonder, is Jim McBride able to hit freeze from that distance there? The breeze seems to have picked up, of course, slightly there, but... If we call half-time now, Marty.
It's been a pulsating opening 37 minutes with Mark Rogers scoring that goal after half an hour, the essential difference between the teams. The atmosphere is electric, the tension is palpable, but we have reached halfway. For Brian Lohan, he must be well pleased with his team. They have performed well after maybe just a little bit of nerves at the beginning. But look at the scene, look at the arena, look at the Munster Hurling final, and thankfully there's another half to go. Half time, Clare, one goal, 11 points. Limerick, 11 points. We'll be right back with analysis and Joanne after the break.
And I think Aberquilligan has done really well. The previous puck out to this one, Joanne, he went long down the middle. Kyle Hayes just won it easily. He has to stay brave, and that's the key. Went to John Conlon. Tony's just shooting for a point. You've got to be Conor Forward's dream. I think of the late Teddy playing with John Fitzgibbon. That was John Fitzgibbon all over. Ball off the post, down. Mark Rogers, when he gets that ball like that, he will finish it. I think the key thing for me there, though, is Aberquilligan has to stay brave with the puck outs. He has to say, if there's a guy on 15, 20 yards of space, I've got to hit him, because if you keep lumping down on Burns and Hayes and Hannon, you won't get the return. But if Mark Rogers, he's 1-1 got now from play, so he must be saying inside that dressing room, this is my day here, come on.
Yeah, well, and he got in again, Joe.
Yeah, he got in again, and same thing again, working the ball out, Clare, going through. Like, Ryan Taylor, as Anthony said, he had a chance before this. Probably should have passed Tony Kelly, but here he took the right option, I think. And Rogers, he took the right option well, bounced the ball. Unbelievable save from Nicky Quaid. I don't think people understand. That's the hardest shot for a goalie to save. Back up the field, Garrodge catches or breaks it to himself. Goes through, probably fouled there. Advantage probably, he had a bit of steps. Fouled again here. Now, probably, like, what happened after here, he kind of trips him more so than that and picks him up a little bit. I think, in fairness, when you see it from behind here, kind of got a knock in the head. I think he just got his left arm under the leg, picks him up. Now, I think Adam Hogan played a little bit as well. He kind of, you can see him on the ground, he's okay, but he wants to be careful. Do you know, he's obviously a looked at man, so he'd want to be careful with what he does. I think a yellow card is enough. I don't think it was a red or anything like that, but just no need for it.
I wonder if you've ever been picked up a little bit by Garrod Hegarty. Well, you do not look like a happy man, Shane Dowling, and you turned around about 10 minutes from the end of that half and you said Galan is the only thing keeping the minute.
But he is. I mean, like, Limerick, you know, they've 11 points got. He's got 7-2 from play, but he's actually won a lot of the frees as well. And when Limerick have had the luxury of getting out, you know, Clare are working hard, but one easy ball to another. David Reedy, they have to spray the ball into the corner. You can see the space there. He robs a couple of yards. In fairness to Keane Nolan, listen, it was a massive decision by Brian Lohan to fire him in there on top of one of the most foreign forwards in the country. And in fairness, Aaron Galan hasn't bet up a stick. Again with Dara Donovan, we can see they're targeting that space. The Clare boys inside, they're trying to keep tight. But this is just unbelievable skill. There are some things that, you know, you can't allow for.
He's on fire as well.
Yeah, he's on fire. He brings the ball out over the shoulder. But, you know, Keane Nolan, in fairness, he's trying his best. You know, we can see here in the next tip as well that Mike Casey, modern day fullback, had nothing on from the puck out, ran up the field, ball in, super turn flick, and taken down by Keane Nolan. But you know, I think it's probably the story of the game, being honest. I know people at home might have the luxury of seeing what's going off the ball. In both full back lines, there's a lot of pulling and dragging. Mike Casey got a yellow card here. He eventually got a yellow card here. You know, Garrod got a yellow card for what he done. I mean, if that's the yellow card, there's a lot more people out there that could have got him as well. But overall, I think Clare are marginally the better team. 11 points. Aaron has 7 of them. There's a lot of players underperforming for Limerick. And I know they played well there a couple of weeks ago against Cork. But, you know, I wouldn't be too confident as it stands right now.
Yeah, but he is keeping a minute. But I think the Clare half back line, Diarmaid Ryan and Tom Morrissey, we spoke about it before, and Diarmaid Ryan is coming way out on top on that. And Davey Mack as well, catching a few puck outs, turning the ball over. They're having a massive say on this game. Like, they haven't hit the heights yet. Neither side have actually played unbelievably well. We still only have, 111 to 11 points. Usually these matches are 16, 17 point games at halftime.
No, but we do have plenty of hurling brains knocking together in dressing rooms at the moment. So it'll be very, very interesting to see what they come up with. Straight to Croke Park after the mayhem in Limerick. Kilkenny with some key men missing from their team, going for 4 titles in a row, but of course their first under their new manager Derek Ling as well. So they've arrived at Croke Park. It's Galway they'll be facing. No sign of the tribe there just yet. That has a 4 o'clock throw in, so we'll be heading over there once this ends. Clare on top, remember, by a goal against Limerick. Limerick underperforming. Shane, the three of you have been chatting about what will change, what should change, what has to change. What have you come up with?
Well, on the Clare side of it, I think they have to put Adam Hogan back in and Aaron Gillan. Keane Nolan's on a yellow card now. I mean, what are John and Paul and the management team saying inside? Will he pepper ball inside to Aaron? Your man is on a yellow card. The one difference I see today, that they've done against Cork is they hit high ball in the top of Aaron against Cork and he caught a couple of them. He hasn't really got any, he's got great low ball in and he has done damage with him. The opportunity for goal just haven't been there. On the Limerick side, there's Cahal O'Neill, Keane Lynch and Peter Casey to come in. I mean, what a trio to bring in. I don't think they'll make a substitution half time. They'll probably wait for 5 or 10 minutes into the second half, wait for the crowd to get involved, bring them all on. And they probably have a stronger bench than Clare have. But if I was Brian Lohan, you'd have to be worried about Keane Nolan, the fullback.
Shamey Flanagan got 8 points in last year's Munster final as well. We haven't seen a huge amount of him, Joe.
No, there hasn't been, but I think they're more targeting Aaron Gillan today more so than Shamey. Like, there hasn't been much ball going into him as such, but as Shane was saying, I'd say they'll change it up a little bit. Maybe they'll run it a little bit more, maybe they might go long. Like, at times, they've often changed at half-time, changed up their tactics, run through the centre, and then get runners going from deep. Now they're hitting a little bit cross-field ball. I think if they do go long and into the goals, they could get a goal or two with Gillan in there.
Clare, of course, they haven't hit their top form either, have they, Anthony? Have they a lot more in them, do you think?
I think they have, Joanne, and I think the chance is there now. If you're in that dressing room, you're saying, lads, kick for glory here, 25 years, what a chance in front of us. I do agree with Shane, we have issues in the full back line. Maybe young Hogan to go back. You have Shane Amore, you have Paul Flanagan. But I think the forwards, nobody really has taken it completely by the scruff of the neck. They've all had their moments. Ryan Taylor started great, Shane O'Donnell started great, Tony was quiet, Tony kicked in with 2 points, hit the ball off the post. Aidan McCarthy got the last score as well, so look at the chances there, and hopefully from our point of view the lads will go all out now to try and bring it home.
You may not realise it, but just a reminder that this is being played in Limerick, despite that massive, massive cheer that you heard for the Clare players who are returning to the pitch. They are leading by a goal, but of course, that sort of a half-time deficit means nothing these days. Let's head back for the second half to Brendan and Marty.
Thank you very much, Joanne. Yes, we're looking forward to this second half. Full house signs have gone up around the grounds here at the Grayley Grounds, and certainly tickets were almost impossible to get. I know people are watching all over the world. Recovery, and I hope you enjoy us the second half of the Munster final. We are thinking of you as we start this Munster hurling final second half with just a goal between the sides. Clare having managed 1-11, 1-8 from play. Here's David Reedy setting about their stall in the early stages. Good score, very good score.
Yeah, that's his skill there. He finds pockets of space. Look on the right of your screen there, you see David Fitzgerald is over on Kyle Hayes now at the start of the second half, and he's coming back down the pitch a bit.
No changes on either side as the ball drops down. Breaking ball picked up by Declan Hannan. Quick hands far as Barry Nash. Kyle Hayes. Barry Nash has gone for the return. Hannan goes down the middle channel. John Conlon, despite 40,000 people, I could hear him say, leave it. And Rory Hayes did. That's a good ball to Johnny Kelly. But his first touch left him down. He recovered well. And he get inside the road, Hegarty. Still Tony Kelly protects himself from the challenge, but he hit it too sharply, too much to the left and wide. Disappointment for the Ballyhea clubman.
It is, just when he didn't get the first ball to hand, he was always going to be under pressure with Hegarty following him.
Just to follow that statistical trail, by the way, Limerick scored 11 points in that first half, 6 from play. Kick forward first, John Conlon. David McInerney calling for it, but David Reedy seems to have been challenging unfairly.
Yeah, whatever bit of a breeze there is in it, Marty, with Limerick now, you can see that last delivery from Nash and went long and high in. Granted, it was swept up here by Conlon, but they will be able to get that ball in that little bit longer now.
Yeah, I see the flags over the stand at the far side blowing a little bit more strongly. You can see the hills of Clare in the background from our camera angle as the ball drops in. Peter Duggan chasing after it. Nicky Quaid underneath it. Safe as always. Under a bit of pressure. Lays it off as Dan Morrissey. and Nicky Quaid was being fouled, so there's a free out for Limerick. Good hands as always, keeps his eye on the ball, Nicky Quaid, an exceptional goalkeeper and very much part of Limerick's success story over the last number of years. And I do believe that tomorrow is his birthday as well. So happy birthday, Nicky Quaid. Well, you have five in a row Munster Championship medals. That would be more important to Nicky, I'd say. As the ball comes out, there is Tom Morrissey. Under a bit of pressure, Graham Mulcahy nips in. Battling hard, John Conlon has the slither in the left paw. Sends it down the middle. He was being humped to his opposite number six, Declan Hannan. He's gone to ground under severe pressure. No foul given. Referee says play on. Bursting forward is Kyle Hayes. Rounds the challenge, still Kyle, heading towards the 45, past the 45, and the Limerick referee says play on.
Yeah, tangle the legs, I think, is what he instructed there.
David McInerney sends it down, but Dan Morrissey is underneath it, took his eye off it slightly. Comes towards Mike Casey. Dermot Burns is available on the wing. Goes long again, aiming for a big Seamus Flanagan, heading out towards the sideline. Can he keep it in? He did well to keep it in. A race for possession. Adam Hogan is there ahead of Graham Mulcahy. Mulcahy, the wily old fox there from Kinmallock, gets the hurley in. That's a compliment to an experienced player as the ball comes back outside and John Conlon has it. Conlon steps away from the challenge, uses the short grip. Available is Aidan McCarthy. Inside him is the goal scorer, Mark Rogers, but McCarthy goes for the score. The umpire is going to signal wide. Wrong call by Aidan McCarthy. He really should have fed Mark Rogers.
Wrong call by a mile there, Marty. The ball needs to go into Rogers there. He's straight in on Nicky Quaid and has a choice, and he goes lower over the bar. Little moments.
Puck out comes past Darrell Donovan. Diagonal ball. This time aiming for Aaron Gillard. John Condon is back there.
That's
ahead of him. But the referee had spotted the infringement.
And he's right.
And he is right.
Yeah, Keane Nolan was tugging with his left arm. He needs to be really, really careful in there now. He's on a yellow. You'd nearly say that that's a tick with it. Once more, and you can see it coming in there. See his left arm wrapped around Galan's hurley holding hand. Like he's walking him up the aisle there. But it's a free.
I think Brian Lohan will have to make a change there.
Yeah, they're talking about underneath us here now.
It is a problem. And he's on a yellow.
Is the backroom team decision will have to be made here now to make a change, I would suggest.
Aaron Gillan lifts and strikes, puts that over the bar, adding to his 7 first half points. One point between the teams again. Straight down the middle towards Tony Kelly. Let's fly. Oh. Hits the slither beautifully. Straight between the posts and over the bar. Now that is Tony Kelly.
His quality. Gets into that cap in the middle of the field. In fairness, really turned around and he was giving it to Burns. Why don't you call me and tell me that he's there? But he's ghosted in behind and broke the tackle.
Puck out by Nicky Quaid. Dropping down in the Clare half. Bouncing ball, breaking ball. William O'Donoghue is onto it. So too is Graham Mulcahy. Referee says Limerick were being fouled, were being held back. And that's going to be a free for Limerick, just to the right of the post. And another simple tap over score for Aaron Gillard.
Yeah, it's just a pull back more so. He's not really going to win early, I'd say, then. And Graham Mulcahy going in.
David McInerney getting an explanation from the referee. A good thing to see.
It is, in the face of Liam Gordon. He's had conversations around the pitch with the players. It's good to see a referee doing that, especially in the high octane atmosphere that we're looking at down there, and the fine march, especially fine.
He hits it high and hits it well over the bar. 1 point between the teams again.
It's amazing. Reedy's in the middle of the pitch now. He's looking over his shoulder trying to find where Tony Kelly is. He's learning.
Long puck out, again, batted away by David Burns, into the pack. David Reedy didn't quite connect. You knew by the way he was holding the hurley, he rushed his shot. Ball is wide, 6 wide of the game for Limerick. Referee Liam Gordon is getting some information.
He's Aidan McCarthy and Declan Hannon in the middle there. We're having a bit of a wrestling match off the ball. He's just pointing at the two of them while the play was going on earlier.
Aver Quilligan goes short and then ops with the long ball, dropping it down towards Peter Duggan. Batted away, Aidan McCarthy got a touch to it. He's also holding Kyle Hayes, got away with it. Shane O'Donnell needs to release the ball. Good work. Ah, oh, brilliant, Barry Nash. Excellent play by the cornerback, but the pass goes astray. Clare could win the set their back, and they do. Mark Rogers, not just a goal scorer, but a grafter as well.
Oh, yeah.
Now that is class. Mark Rogers, oozing from every pore in his body, the DNA that is the hurling gene.
Yeah,
look at this.
Yeah, he bet Declan Hannon that foot race out as well. Hannon gave him, had 2 yards of a start. Rogers tossed him out. That possession.
Puck out as quickly, take down towards David Reedy. Ball is dropping in towards that. Oh, that's a sweet ball to Aaron Galan. He's setting up for the goal. Here it comes. Back in the net.
Too slow on the switch, Marty, I'm afraid. Shane Dowley said it at half-time that Keane Nolan was under serious pressure in there. Galan gone one-on-one again. Nolan slipped. See it here. Spun him around lovely. This time he couldn't pull him down. It'd be black card territory. One bounce past the goalkeeper. That's the quality of Galan. He'd have been saying it at half-time, Marty. Look, lads, I've acres of space inside. Just get me one bounce in, and I'll do that.
Unstoppable. Aaron Galan. Goal and 9 points in this Munster final. But the move that we've been talking about, Brendan, if I may say so, since around 2 o'clock, hasn't happened. Down at the other end, Clare going forward. The referee has his arm up. He's going to give a free. There was no advantage developing, and there's a free in for Clare.
Well, the positive thing for Clare and Marty is obviously they're creating goal-scoring chances. Again, that was another opportunity there, and the pass just didn't get away. You see here Kyle Hayes in a tackle. The jersey being tugged as well by Will O'Donoghue. And just Kyle Hayes then there with a little bit of afters then onto the shoulder. It's one of those moments as well, I suppose, when you slow it down. It always looks that touch worse than those examples, yeah. In fairness.
Almost looked like a throw ball as well, Brendan, when you look at it in slow motion, yeah. There.
But more important thing is that McCarthy has an opportunity now to level the game again.
Shane Meehan is coming on for Clare. And the player that's going off is Aidan McCarthy. It surprises me a little bit, Brendan, does it you?
A little, yeah, I suppose. They probably wanted more legs around that middle third, because that green wave is starting to come up along the pitch. Tony Kelly now takes over the free taking responsibilities.
This to level the match for the fourth time. Tony Kelly facing difficult enough angle, heading down towards those Ennis Road goalposts. Follow through is good, never in any doubt. Tony Kelly gets his fourth point of the game.
Yeah, Duggan comes out to the half ball right now. Meehan stays, I would expect, inside.
William O'Donoghue. Darrow O'Donovan. John Conley. Seamus Flanagan. Knocking it back cleverly. Farris Tom Morrissey. Oh, fantastic. Now that's why they're the Munster and All-Ireland champions. Because when you have classy players like Tom Morrissey that steps up here under pressure, and this is a pressure cooker, the Munster final, and score points like that.
Yeah, here we go now. Peter Casey's in for Graham Mulcahy, but again a class point from Morrissey. Hits the ball high over his head, over the bar.
Peter Casey on. Graham Mulcahy has done his bit as the technical games along the sideline are played out. Limerick leading by a point. Aver Quilligan going long again. Down towards Shane O'Donnell. Ball bouncing. Picked up by Garrod Hegarty. Looks and has the time. Send it down towards Aaron Galan. Keane Nolan struggling with him. Aaron Galan,
yeah.
Sending that over the bar.
Yeah, change has to be coming soon now. I don't know how much longer we can look at Keane Nolan inside there, but you can see the space inside, but 3 or 4 or 5 yards off of Aaron Galan. In that case, you might as well be on the other side of the field to give that man a foot is too much.
goal and 10 points for Aaron Gillan. I wonder when will Clare make that tactical move, because certainly Keane Nolan is struggling, trying to mark him now at this stage. Ball is passed out. Chance for Tony Kelly. Right of the post, blocked down, knocked away. Limerick beginning to show their class. Darrell Donovan going long. Again towards Aaron Gillan. Trouble immediately, and he turns him so easily, and he's heading towards goal. Under 20. 13 shot. Brilliant save by Eva Quilligan. Out towards John Conlon. And the referee has given a free out.
Yeah, I feel for Keane Nolan down there, Marty. It's the one sign when a guy is nervous, he's on the ground more times than he's standing up. And Keane Nolan is starting to slip and slide around the Gaelic grounds. Gillan comes in. And of course he was going to go low. Quilligan did well. It's a nice height for the goalkeeper.
Quilligan did very well here, Brendan.
He did, it's a good save. Good and he save. Broke it away too, which is key, high and away from the danger area.
Ball comes down for us, Dermot Ryan. Breaking ball, coming through, at speed. It's Mark Rogers again, he gets a pull on the ball. Easy for Nicky Quaid. Down for us, William O'Donoghue, in the D. Unmarked at the moment is David Reedy. Looking at the post, going for the point. Has he the strength, has he the legs? Yes, he has. Great score, David Reedy. His second point of the game.
Yeah, he's picking up those pockets of space there. We saw it last year, actually, against Galway in the All-Ireland semi-final. He come on, he finds space. Deadly accurate there. More concerning for Limerick up the other end of the field is that Mike Casey's down. His left ankle there looks like he rolled it in the last passage of play. Decision for John Kiley below, having that conversation now. And another decision up the other end for Brian Lohan as to what he's going to do with Nolan inside and Gillan.
I see Shane and Morey is warming up in front of us off camera as we're looking at Mike Casey. There's Shane and Morey, won an All-Ireland medal in 2013. He obviously is going to come in to the Clare defence. Whether that means in the full back line, half back line is normally his place of residence, but let's see what happens. So Shane Morey making way for Keane Nolan, who's played his part in this Munster hurling final. Very testing afternoon for him, for a young man who hadn't played any championship matches so far in this campaign, which was a big ask.
No doubt. No doubt it is. But now it's Shane Morey is the man inside. Wrestling with Gillan already.
Breaking ball. Tony Kelly, the king, has it. Manages to get up for Shane O'Donnell. Being pursued by Tom Morrissey. Still Shane O'Donnell. Trying to get his way through. Dancing around. Lays it off. Did he take too many steps? Here's Shane Meehan. Giving it back right. Mark Rogers. Little dummy. About to get the shot in. But this is ferocious defending by Limerick. Superb. As the ball is there between the 13 metre line and the 20. Look at that by Limerick defending, putting in the hits fair and square, just chasing the slipper. Gerard Hegarty backtracking towards the corner flag, about to pull the ball and gets it blocked superbly by Peter Duggan. Ball is put out over the sideline. There was pushing on Mark Rogers. Referee is correct, it's a free in for Clare.
Yeah, he's wrapping the action, in his hold. It's the tackle now, and Hurling's gone a bit like football. Put in your hand to take it out. The referee is showing there, the both arms are in around. What an unbelievable passage of play in the heat that we have down there. You see both hands coming in, although in fairness to Will O'Donoghue, he did take his hand back out.
When you look at the replay, it was a bit of a soft free, wasn't it, Brendan?
It was, to be fair. He did take his hands back out. He didn't wrap them all the way around the Clare player.
43,756. Massive crowd at this Munster hurling final. Just been announced full house, as I mentioned earlier. A little bit of concern about Mark Rogers there. Knowing the Rogers and the great family in Scariff, I can assure you, he won't be coming off that easily.
Well, and all the players around the pitch are taking on water. You see the run from Shane O'Donnell there. It's the wing forward. Morrissey was tracking him back. Twinkle toes around, gets the pass over. Again, hooking and blocking, coming in from all angles. There's Casey coming back to win back possession. Everybody fighting to protect their own goal. Either way, opportunity for Tony.
19 minutes are there to go. Difficult enough angle. The ball is wide. It's Clare's ninth wide of the game.
Big swings is half time now. Obviously, Limerick on 3 points ahead.
Clare were 111 to 11 in front at the break. They've turned it around magnificently. Peter Casey Billy Casey was clearly being fouled, and that's going to be a free in for Limerick.
There's Adam Hogan, he did well there to stop Casey releasing the ball because Hegarty had drifted inside him. Again, you see the swarm defences in there. Very hard if your referee tries to decide it's a free out for overcarrying or a free in, but in fairness, I think the higher arm across the shoulder of Casey was the deciding factor.
Aaron Gillan, 110 to his credit so far. Never in any doubt. 111 out of that 118. It's pretty awesome. Aver Quilligan goes down the middle. Ball skips off the Hurley. Ryan Taylor, John Conlon is there trying to kick it out. Good work by Shane O'Donnell. Continues to work hard. Advantage being given. David Fitzgerald on his shoulder was Jim O'Brien. Jim O'Brien trying to take the shot. The referee had his arm up. No advantage being given. He felt that Jim O'Brien had the time to take the shot.
Yeah, he left it broad. In fairness, he's been relatively consistent on that tease. But it was Darrow Donovan who got him. Jim O'Brien now has the helmet off, just giving himself an opportunity to get back. But the ref is letting play go on.
Barry Nash goes long. Brilliantly caught. David Reedy looking for support of Garrod Hegarty. Tom Morrissey is there. The referee has his arm stretched. He's allowing the play to continue on. And that's over the bar. Great play by Limerick. That's Tom Morrissey's third point of the match.
Reedy, look at that. The height that he's gotten up. He's had a huge influence on this game, Marty. He's had that composure to top it back for an easy score. The Morrissey. Now it looks like below that we're going to have Colin Coughlin coming in.
Colin Coughlin from Valley Brown is right. He's coming on for Declan Hannon. Fine hurler, this lad. I've seen him play previously in the championship, but also indeed in the league. I think he'd be an automatic choice in every other county in Ireland.
Oh, he's only 21. And the fairness of Declan Hannon, about 4 or 5 minutes ago, around the middle third of the pitch, it looks like he got a dead leg in the quad there on his left. He was struggling a little. In fairness, he did put his hand up and say, "I need to come off," which is experience as well.
Declan Hannon, captain of this Limerick team over a golden era for the Shannonsiders, as Clare tried to find the rhythm again. Well won by Peter Duggan, giving it into the path. There's an opportunity here, but the first touch by Ryan Taylor left him down. It was unlucky. Comes back out first, David Fitzgerald, making an angle for himself, takes a shot in. Nicky Quaid is there, bats it forward. Clare looking for the scores now to get him back into the match. Comes back out first, Tony Kelly. Tony, blocked down. Brilliant, Kyle Hayes. Putting the hard work in. The rebound comes out to the All-Ireland and Munster champions. And they're looking like Munster and All-Ireland champions now. David Reedy sending it over towards Aaron Gillan. Can he turn Shane Morey? He can't. Morey gets a little shot in. Just enough to get it first. Malone. Malone turns. Gives it back for Shane Morey. Shane Morey bypasses the first challenge. David Reedy loves to run an opponent. Referee says play on. No, he doesn't. Well, he does. He's giving him the advantage. Shane O'Donnell, front of the post. Will he allow it to stand? Yeah. Yes, he will. That's over the bar. Brilliant play by Clare. It's their first score in 10 minutes.
It is. Shane Morey's winded there a bit now. You can see the shot Kyle Hayes got him just to release it. Kyle Hayes, I think, is going to get a yellow card and earn the middle of the field. But again, Tony Kelly blocked down. It's the second time it's happened in this half. We're trying to expect him to get it high over the advancing players. Hurley just hits him. By the way, it's a time Clare really needed. You see here, you see the instant again. Kyle Hayes lined him up. Yellow card. Shane Morey looks like he's fine.
Yellow card for the number 7. As Clare introduce Aaron Shanahan. It's Peter Duggan that's going to be making way as Clare rearrange the forward lineup in a hope to break down this Limerick defence. They're 14 minutes or more to reduce down that 4-point advantage that the champions presently hold.
Limerick now as well, ball on the bench.
Cathal O'Neill is going to be introduced by John Kiley. It was in the original lineup that was announced during the week.
Cahill O'Neill replaces number 12, Tom Morrissey.
Richie English also has been introduced. Those two players coming on.
Casey, I think, is the one. He's
Tom Morrissey and Mike Casey.
Took up a knock there, Casey, in fairness, his ankle. He wasn't able to run it off. Good experience to have him, Richie English coming in.
Long puck out, coming down, trying to attack the ball. It's the left corner back, Rory Hayes. Clare under pressure in the all half back line. This time, John Conlon is fouled, and it's a free for the Banner County boys. There was still time for Clare to rectify the situation here, but they are struggling. The Ireland and Munster champions have been absolutely brilliant in this second half. Mark Rogers has taken over the free taking here. The long range frees haven't worked out for them this afternoon for Clare. He hits this well, it's dropping in. Attacking the ball is Dan Morrissey, knocking it out. Shane O'Donnell skips by the first challenge, trying to, he's well surrounded, he's nowhere to go. Kyle Hayes is in there, still Shane O'Donnell. Kyle Hayes comes away with it. Blocked on this occasion, good work by Clare, by Aaron Shannon. The hits are going in, shoulder to shoulder, and a little bit more. Sideline ball, which way is it going? It's going to Clare.
Clare supports on the far side, aren't overly happy with Kyle Hayes. You can see Shannon here, great block, look at that. Hurley goes in halves as well. Never mind that, he loses the hurley and he goes again.
Such courage. David Fitzgerald taking the sideline ball as Brian Lohan watches along the sideline. Again, Shane O'Donnell, David Fitzgerald are going from a very tight angle. And that is lashed over the bar.
Some hands from Shane O'Donnell there, like the ball was cut. And he just seemed, I don't know how he caught it, but he got it through to Fitzgerald, just blazed it over the bar. Exactly what Clare needed now to get the crowd behind him, you can hear it.
And judging by the saffron and blue that seems to be everywhere, I'm not too sure there's anybody back in the Banner County, because the roaring is absolutely ginormous here. Paul Malone sending it down, but Barry Nash has the situation well read. Kyle Hayes is calling for it. Dermot Burns is available as well. Tony Kelly was coming in to hook him but didn't quite connect. Down towards Seamus Flanagan. Avery Quilligan has all the time in the world to go long. Sending it down, Barry Nash again coming across to anticipate what's happening. Shane O'Donnell slipped and slide. Totally accidental. High challenge by Dermot Ryan on Paul O'Neill. Got away with it. Comes back as Limerick go in pursuit of more scores. This time, one ball is won by David McInerney. Laying it off quickly. Tony Kelly wanted it short. There's too many Limerick players up there from a Clare point of view. Nipping in. Good work. Carl Malone is almost on his own. He has to try and find somebody available. He finds the right man. His midfield partner, David Fitzgerald. Mickey Quaid puts the hurley over the crossbar to make sure it doesn't register a point. And Limerick come away with it again. Dermot Burns going for distance. The road Hegarty underneath it. Knocked away by Shane Moran. In comes Rory Hayes, Shane Amore, free to Clare. 10 minutes to go. 3 points between the teams. Cramp developing for Clare.
Yeah, Rory Hayes done really well inside on Flanagan. Actually, the last two plays, he played Flanagan really well to let the ball through to Quilligan, who actually hit the ball long. And in fairness to Quilligan, he needs to be a little bit more like Nicky Quaid now in these last 10 minutes if Clare are to win. Use the ball smartly, be brave.
Rory Hayes still getting some attention.
Dara Donovan is coming off as well with the blood soap in the middle of the pitch. You'd expect he wouldn't be off for long, yeah.
The change is necessary, but it also gives both teams a breather in this sweltering heat. It's about 23 degrees, but very humid as well. As Limerick introduced another substitute, that's Adam English.
I think the last thing Clare need as well now is Rory Hayes to be out.
Just for the record, by the way, Limerick scores in the second half. They were 111 to 11 points down. They've scored 1-8 in the second half to Clare's 5 points. So physically, in terms of possession, in terms of the scoreboard, Limerick have clearly won this second half and won it handsomely. And yet, there's only 3 points between the teams. Good hands, Rory Hayes. Avery Quilligan. David McInerney into the middle towards Dermot Ryan. gets it over first, John Conlon, despite Garrod Hegarty's efforts to block it. Still John Conlon, stopped on this occasion by Peter Casey. Let's fly with a ball that is dropping in. Aaron Shanahan keeps it in somehow. Nicky Quaid is there. Clare need a little bit more options up front. They just seem to be static with little or no running into space. As Limerick come away with it with Kyle Hayes. Adam English steps into the cauldron of a Munster hurling final with his very first touch, and that is over the bar. That is a great score for a young man playing in his first Munster final.
First touch of the ball, Adam English over the bar, steps out now to sit down again, gets the high five from Dermot Burns. But Kyle Hayes again, Marty, has that influence on the game. He got the ball, broke a couple of tackles and got the ball away to Adam English.
Long puck out from Aver Quilligan, knocked down into the path of Malone. David Fitzgerald wants it quickly. This is David Fitzgerald looking for options available, decides to have a go himself and sends that over the bar for his second point. It reduces Limerick's lead again to 3 points. 7 minutes to go. Can Limerick hold on and do the five in a row? Or can Clare get back and equalise this match? Two major questions when you've 6.5 minutes of normal playing time left. Ball comes down to Seamus Flanagan. Sideline ball is going to Clare. David McInerney, going to take this. Son of Jim, of course, who won a medal back in 1995, part of the 2013 team that won the All-Ireland as well. Little flick back, David Fitzgerald. It's two against two. Aaron Shanahan, what can he do? He can turn, shoot and score. It's a great response by Clare. They're still in the match. They still have a chance.
They certainly have, Marty, and they don't have Declan Hannan sitting now there on the Limerick anymore to try to cut off the ball there. Turns to Adam English. He's going to see the action full time now. He's come on for Seamus Flanagan.
Ian Galvin is coming on for Clare. Seamus Flanagan has gone off for Limerick. Shane Meehan is on as well, of course. We have 5 minutes and a bit to go. 2 points between the teams. Ball breaks free. Getting it down for us, Tony Kelly. Kelly makes specs. Sends it in low to Shane O'Donnell. Shane O'Donnell taking on Barry Nash. Looks for the reinforcements. It arrives in Tony Kelly, who gave him the ball the first time. Ball is sent in. Ball is gone to the right and wide. But the referee had his arm up for a jersey pull. No advantage accruing. And he's given a free to Clare.
Interesting to see it again. Didn't spot it, but it must have been on Shane O'Donnell or something there when the ball came in. We'll see it here again. There's the left arm on Shane O'Donnell's shoulder. Did it grip the jersey is the question. And Nash.
Not enough replay.
No, it certainly didn't.
And listen to the crowd. Getting behind our team. Clare, Clare, Clare is the message as Tony Kelly lifts, strikes and scores. It's his fifth point of the game. By his standards, he's had a quiet afternoon.
He has, but if he can come to life here in the last 4 or 5 minutes, he'll be on the ball a couple of times there. Things start to happen for Clare, obviously, when their talisman is on it.
Despite Limerick's brilliant second half performance, they find themselves only 1 point in front. Ball is dropping in. Ball is dropping wide. There's still time for Clare to get an equaliser. Attention.
And you know too, Martin, when you're down the pitch, you start to see the high-vis jackets moving around the outside. You know then there's 5 minutes left and just adds to the tension of this affair.
Adam Hogan dropping it down. Nicely picked up. Trying to make an angle for himself. Here comes the shot. Dropping it in to Tony Kelly. Didn't quite get behind it. Ian Galvin says hard luck. Meanwhile, it's Limerick that worked the ball out with Colin Cochran down the middle. Attacking the ball again. Good work on this occasion by Ryan Taylor. Knew he was going to be hooked by David Reedy. Gets a little bit of space. Ryan Taylor, is this equaliser? No, it's not. The ooze and the size are from Clare people.
Roll of the eyes there from Ryan Taylor. He looked like he did absolutely everything right. Take your time. Then get the shot away, but just pulled it left of the post.
Paul Flanagan is on for Clare. Rory Hayes is the player that's making way, giving a clenched fist salute to say we can do it. But can they? Can Clare? In 2.5 minutes, pull back Limerick. There's only 1 point between them. They've already been levelled 4 times in this game. Ball breaking down. William O'Donoghue got his hands to it. John Conlon comes in. Gives a powerful ball up towards Ian Galvin and company. Breaking ball favours Limerick. Barry Nash. Nicky Quaid calls for it. Backfires the keeper. Looking around at angles. Goes for a distance. Rawai's call. Puts the pressure on the Clare defence. Up goes Garrod Hegarty. Knocked away on this occasion. Adam English coming through. Trying to make an angle for himself. Half blocked. Ball into the space. And the ball is rolling out over the sideline. Linesman is going to indicate that it is a Clare ball. Not too sure. I thought there was a break, a knockdown there. But anyway, linesman had no doubt. 119, 120. 68 minutes and 30 seconds on the clock. Remember, it's results on the day. Are we going to head to extra time? The lads with the bibs might be out, but there's still time. Ball breaks. Nipping in, trying to scoop it up. Ball is available. Colin Malone almost had it. Comes to Shane O'Donnell, who continues to play his heart out. David Fitzgerald, is he the equaliser? Hits it powerfully, and he hits it wide again. That is the 12th wide of the match for Clare.
It's two bad ones there now, Marty, it has to be said. Limerick are away quickly again. O'Neill's on his own this side of the pitch.
Trying to attack the ball. Trying to get it away is Dermot Ryan. Ball loose and available. Trying to get in the shot. This one is sailing between the posts and it's over the bar. It's Carl O'Neill. Is that the match winner? That gives Limerick a 2-point breathing space.
4 minutes, Marty, seems the court official blows. Limerick turn them over again.
The road Hegarty intercepts the tuck out from Eber Quilligan to David McInerney, but he wasn't able to put it between the posts. 69 minutes 40 seconds. Ball comes all the way out towards John Conlon. William O'Donoghue copped on very quickly. The ball was coming his way. Still Conlon trying to lay it off. Ian Galvin stepping away from the challenge. Despite the best efforts of being hooked, he puts that between the posts and over the bar. It is 1 point again between the teams, and we are hitting the 70th minute of this Munster hurling final. The nerves are jangling. The hurling is exceptional and the atmosphere is electric. As what a wonderful, wonderful score by David Reedy from along the sideline, straight from Nicky Quaid's puck out.
Yeah, fatigue's a big factor down there for both defences. Not able to pick up as quickly or as sharp as they were. These are the championship minutes of the same, Marty.
Ian Galvin looking around to see where he can pass the ball to. Eventually gets it out. David Fitzgerald is under pressure on the ground, no free given. Limerick have the possession back. Skipping away from the challenge is Dermot Burns. Chasing after him is Ryan Taylor. Dermot Burns, snap fouls as the referee, and Limerick lose the possession. Clare have it once more, flicking it out. Can they create an opportunity? Tony Kelly is available there. Just a little touch, added a two. Gives a chance for Clare to score from a very difficult angle, but this time there is no doubt. White flag is raised. Ian Galvin is the man. Just 1 point between the teams, 3 minutes of injury time to go.
Yeah, loads of time left, Marty. Again, you see Kelly going on inside, you just wonder, but anyway, point in it.
It's been a monster final to talk about for a long time. Ball is plucked out by Nicky Quaid. Adam English picks it up, gets a little bit of space, turns, shoots, but this time sends it wide. He's a very good hurler, this young lad.
Serious there now, just some hard luck.
And our sympathies to the English family. Indeed, I know that there was a bereavement during the week, but Alan is playing here on behalf of his uncle, I've no doubt about that. As the ball comes back out first, Carl O'Neill, as the ball is sent in, this is going over the bar.
Yeah, loose puck out from Quilligan. A little bit giddy on it, went long, turned over, obviously. to a Limerick jersey. If you do that, a man in shot will punish it.
72 minutes, 2 minutes of injury time. Great catch. Clareman has the ball, trying to get it out towards Tony Kelly. Hit it a little bit too hard. Loose ball available. Dermot Burns puts his head down, flicks it on for Kyle Hayes. Kyle Hayes going to be hooked, trying to stop him. Two Clare lads. One of them is David McInerney. 7-on-7. Ryan Taylor is there in support. Still Ryan Taylor. Still David McInerney. Hand passing it down the middle towards Ian Galvin, laying it off. Is there anybody in around the house? It's two against two again. As once more Dan Morrissey comes out to tackle the ball. Limerick have it, giving it back for Nicky Quaid. 72 minutes and 50 seconds coming on the clock. Going for distance, Tom Conlon. One man up is Aaron Galan. But Clare have it with Paul Flanagan. Tom Conlon wants it short. Conlon gets it. 73 minutes now, just a minute to go. Can they produce something out of this? Dermot Ryan trying to skip away from the shackles of Colin O'Neill, dropping this in around the house. Aaron Shannon goes up for it. Ball comes on to Shane O'Donnell. Nicked away on this occasion. Barry Nash. Clare is down on the ground. Barry Nash trying to slow matters down. 40 seconds left in the injury time. Ball is sent across field. Ryan Taylor has it, or should have it. Is available.
Limerick are all back in their own defence now. Game of backs and forwards for the last 40 seconds.
Ryan Taylor dropping this in between the D. Three Limerick players, but it comes instead to Tony Kelly. Tony Kelly goes for the point and scores, and a white flag is raised. There is now just 1 point between the teams, and we're heading towards the 74th minute.
And Kinnerth is below with Kiley. The two of them are telling their players to push back down the pitch. Don't sit back. There's only a point in it. We need to win this puck out.
We're on the 74th minute. 6 seconds to go. After this, it's all up to the referee. The referee not looking at his watch yet. Who gets the possession here? Breaking ball favours William O'Donnell. Does a little shimmy to the left. About to take a shot. Ball comes in towards Eva Quilligan. Leaves it go out. Ball is wide. Quickly taken. There's still time on the clock. John Conlon sends it down the middle towards Shane O'Donnell. For the referee.
No, he's calling it back.
That call. He wants the puck out to be taken properly.
He does. It's not over.
It's not over. The crowds are on the field, but they're going to have to be put back. Limerick are celebrating a one-point victory, but the referee has not blown his full-time whistle. He wanted the puck out to be taken by Eva Quilligan. Now, will he just blow the full-time whistle, or will he, in fact, get everybody off the field and play an extra minute? Brian Lohan is coming on and protesting with the referee. But Liam Gordon is saying, I think, if I can read the body language, he wants the puck out to be taken properly.
He does, and I don't think he's going to blow it up on the puck out. Brian Lohan is heading up around to all these players there, explaining what's going on, keeping it wide. Yeah, he's going to let the puck out go, I'd say, based on Brian Lohan's reaction with his forwards. So hopefully everybody gets back off the pitch and we can get going again, and hearts can start racing once more, Marty.
How much will Liam Gordon, the referee, allow? Possession for Clare here is crucial. But Limerick have it. Dermot Burns trying to step away. Stopped in his tracks. Tony Kelly, Shane O'Donnell. There's a scramble on the Limerick 45. Trying to get it up in the Hurling. Doing good work as Aaron Shannon gives it back. Here's the right corner back. He's surely fouled. The referee says no free. And the referee blows the full-time whistle. And Clare are protesting that there should have been a free. Limerick are celebrating that John Kiley, in his 11th final previously and won 11 cups, 11 silverware, has done it again.
Yeah, Brian Nolan's gone out to the referee there. They're off to wait maybe until he gets him inside. He may have a case, all right. The referee would have taught both players, Tony Kelly and the last to be fouled, were trying to play for it. I'm not so sure, but either way, just hope the referee can get off the pitch here now.
Liam Gordon is coming off. Brian Lohan was quickly in to protest. And there looked to be a foul at the very end. It looked like there could have been a free at the very end. But instead, the referee blew the full-time whistle. And John Kiley and Brian Lohan, I have no doubt, commiserate and celebrate and congratulate each other. Now, was this... this was the incident again. There was a scramble just on the 45-metre line. Aaron Shanahan got it back.
See, Tony Kelly there, you see, was crashed into by Casey straight in the chest. And then after that, then, of course, the Clare attacker was bottled up. Claims from the banner obviously will be that the tackle was high around the shoulder, just above the shoulder area. Either way, result is in the books now, Marty.
It sure is, and Limerick have won the Munster Championship for the fifth year in a row. Amazing to equal what Cork did from 1982 to 1986. But these Limerick hurlers are outstanding, and nobody can begrudge them that little bit of history of five Munster titles in a row. They fought magnificently in the second half. They were 111 to 11 points down at the break. They dominated the second half, and yet Clare stuck in, and they were still within a shouting distance, within 1 point of the Munster and All-Ireland champions. Limerick, Munster champions, five in a row.
Marty and Brendan, thank you very much for that, and such scenes here. They had to have take two, the Limerick fans did, but they're going to make the most of them, no doubt about that. Shane, even more history for your county.
Incredible, Joanne. You know, people, for a long time in Limerick, you know, there was no success whatsoever. You know, to win five in a row Munsters is just, it's unbelievable. The job that John, Paul and the management team have done to this special group of players is just second to none. And they won by a point today. I know we'll come to the talking point at the end for a finish. But to be able to win all these games at the end by 1 and 2 points, it takes something special, and they're a special, special group.
OK, we'll get more on that from you. We'll get Anthony's reaction to Clare's feet as well. Joe Canning, man of the match today. There wasn't much of an argument about this, was there?
No, Aaron Gallan for us, man of the match today. In fairness, Keane Nolan got in at the last minute, couldn't do much with him. So, yeah, fair play to Aaron. He showed his work for Limerick today.
He certainly did. Not for the first time. Aaron Gallan is man of the match on Munster final day, and he's with Damien.
Thanks very much, Joanne. Owen Cleary from Ayr is here to present Aaron with the Ayr man of the match. Congratulations, Aaron. And thank you very much, Owen. Aaron, how much do you enjoy a day like today?
I don't know what we said. We enjoyed it for 70 minutes there. We just had to get the job done, but I suppose we'll enjoy it now. Look, we've done... I have a massive achievement, five in a row, so we'll definitely enjoy it now.
I'll pop in here beside you. Just in terms of Conor Cleary missed out today, and I suppose the big job for Keane Nolan to come on. On days like today, no matter who you're marking, when the ball comes to you and you know you're in the zone, do you just want it to keep coming to you?
Yeah, look, I suppose on a day like that, I had the easy job. Like, I had the likes of Dara and Declan giving in perfect balls, so it doesn't really matter who you're marking, but I suppose just to touch on Conor Cleary there, he got an awful injury a couple of weeks ago, and hopefully he recovers well soon.
Can you make any sense out of that game? Like, in terms of the first half, they looked to have a little bit of a march on you, but they maybe missed 2-1. And in the second half, you seemed to clog up all that space and kind of turn the screw on them.
Sure, look, I don't know. It's hard to put into words. There's nothing between the two teams. You've seen that for the last couple of years. What was it for a finish? Maybe a point or 2 points. They could have very easily come out on top as well. So a super team, to be fair, and they definitely put it up to us today.
A last question for you. For the first few years of your career, I was talking to you about the step up you made from the B team under 16, and you're sick of me talking about that, but for the last 2 or 3 years, to reach the level that you have, and as a team the level you have, how have you managed just to kind of keep it ticking over, keep those desire levels up day after day?
It's a great help, like going to training there Tuesday, Friday, Sunday, and you're meeting the likes of Paul Kinnock, and like the stuff that man can teach you is unbelievable, so you'll be foolish not to want to keep learning. So it's a credit to Paul as well, and he has that impact in the whole on the 37 people on the panel, so fair play to him.
Okay, enjoy yourself, enjoy the win. Congrats, Aaron.
Sound, Damien. Thanks a million.
Back to you, Joanne.
What a performance Aaron Gallan had from start. He tired possibly towards the end, but he had done so much damage at that stage. Another man, of course, you would have soldiered alongside, Shane. When they badly needed him, when Limerick weren't particularly performing well in the first half, and then when they came roaring out in the second half, he was there.
Yeah, listen, we said it at half-time. He was just giving an exhibition throughout the whole game from minute one. You know, in fairness to Shane Amore, when he did come on, he done quite well. The first ball he went in, he won it. But, I mean, he was the man, early days, he was the man that kept Limerick in the game. To be fair, the ball that was going in was unbelievable. I have to say that now as well. And he did reference that as well. But he's downplaying it. It's what he did when the ball came in was just, you know, with all Joe, myself, anyone that played in the forwards, you dream of getting ball like that. But David Reedy was unbelievable in the second half. Great ball in. At this stage, Keane Nolan, he was on a yellow card. He couldn't take him down. He stuck it into the back of the net. It's the diagonal ball that probably killed Clare throughout the whole game. He was a man on fire. I have to say that, Joanne, it's very easy for us to stand up here in a fancy box and talk about the game that we love. But Clare got it wrong today, right? Keane Nolan, it's his first day out, throwing him into a Munster final and then leaving him there for 55 minutes. You know, Shane Amore, the change should have been made earlier. And, you know, he just... he had one of them days that we'd all only love to have a Munster final.
In fairness to you, Shane, you did argue that the ball in the first half was a bit wide. That was the best ball in terms of near the goals, and once he won it then the goal is on. But I agree with you, like, I wouldn't mind starting Keane Nolan because he has played a good lot, but he should have been gone at that stage. Look at the young lad, he's only there to do his best. He should have been gone, Joanne. The change was there. We had Shane Amora, we had Paul Flanagan. They both did really well when they came on. So that change should have been made.
But in fairness to Keane Nolan, right, no matter if you had any cornerback in there, if you had Sean Finn in there, he couldn't handle Aaron Gillan today. The ball going in is so good. There's only so much a cornerback can do. I know they can gamble, but Gillan is so good in behind as well that if they change it up and hit it in long, he's under pressure. The problems happened out the field. I wouldn't necessarily blame Keane Nolan. The problems happened out the field that Limerick had the time to hit great ball in.
100%, Joe. That didn't lose the match, Joanne, as we've seen. It's the misses Clare had lost the match. From Clare point of view, credit to Limerick. Great champions find a way, and they did.
What do you think about that, Joe, saying the issues, Shane, were out the field for Clare?
I couldn't agree more with him, but what I'm saying is, I'd agree with Dalo. Start, no problem, but I mean, make a decision, make a substitution earlier on. That's just a big thing. As I said, very easy to do it from here, but it was quite obvious today.
From Keane Nolan's point of view, because this is going to be difficult for him, isn't it? I think he nearly looked relieved when he was finally taken off.
Maybe so, and it's an awful baptism of fire to fire a guy in and a guy of Aaron Gillan's calibre. I think maybe they just put Adam Hogan in there first, but anyway, it is what it is, and he tough yoke, he'd be there to fight.
End of the day, the wides near in the fourth quarter cost Clare.
The wides beat us, and the ball's dropped short, and the ball's blocked down.
Yeah.
So we lost again.
These men in green are used to making history, and they've done it here on their home patch. So Declan Hannan about to put his hands on the Mickey Mackey Cup once again. So back to Marty.
Yes, indeed. Look at that for a sea of green and white. As once again, another chapter in the story of Limerick hurling continues on with this golden era. They're an exceptional group of hurlers. They were tested this afternoon and they responded magnificently with a great second half performance. And nothing or anyone can take that away from John Kiley, Tom Morrissey and the rest of the Limerick squad. It really is a special moment. As Aaron Gillan deservedly gets man of the match in this Munster hurling final, with John Kiley, remarkable managerial career, 7 years in charge, and certainly finding it difficult to believe the moment. Ger Ryan, chairman of the Munster Council, hands over the Mick Mackey trophy in the presence of the president of the GAA, Barry McCarthy, to Declan Hannan. Limerick, Munster champions, 5 in a row. Well done, Limerick.
Tánáthasórum an Corán Seo Glacha ar son Fhoireann Limné. I'm not going to delay you too long today because I can feel the party atmosphere bubbling over already. So just to John Kiley, the management team that he's put in place over the last number of years to give us everything we need to perform on the pitch today, to do 5 in a row in Munster. John, the entire management team, thank you very much. Our fantastic sponsors JP and Nori McManus, the McManus family, for their continued support. Only for you wouldn't be here at all. I hope you're enjoying these days. To the Limerick County Board, who do everything possible again to put us onto the pitch in the best way we can. To Mike, Sean, Seamus, thank you very much and the best of luck for your term. To all the players' families, wives, partners, girlfriends, partners, everything. What you put up with is amazing. We thank you from the bottom of our heart. We can't wait to celebrate with you later on. So today's match officials, no doubt a very tough game to ref. The conditions, the tightness of the game. Just congratulations, you did a very, very good job. To Clare, and your incredible supporters that came here in numbers today. Another titanic battle with you. We wish you the best of luck for the rest of the year. We might meet with you again. And finally, to the most fantastic supporters in all of Ireland. The sea of green and white is absolutely special to see. Us as players are not getting tired of these days. We hope you never get tired of them either. Limerick Camu!
You would imagine that Declan Hannan would be getting bored of all these trophies he's to lift, but no, he looks like he's enjoying every single second of it. Why not? Such an incredible record for John Kiely. 12 finals, 12 victories. That's just unbelievable, Shane.
That's incredible. You can only dream of days like this. I remember 2013, Joanne, we played Cork here in the Munster final. Hadn't won one in a long, long time. And the scenes here are nearly better. And that's after winning five in a row. You know, what the management team have done, I keep going back to it. You know, they have the best management team in the country. You know, the best psychologist, the best manager, the best coach, the best selectors. A fantastic county board, a fantastic sponsor, all pulling in the one direction. That's the difference. Everybody's pulling in the one direction. As I said earlier, there's no difference. The fact that you're winning all these games by 1 point, by 2 points, that makes a massive difference.
They're going
anyway,
mad here
behind him, you're going wrong.
He's fairly missed it now.
Dalo, turn around there, turn around there.
I'm sure you can see that behind us. They're dancing just like Shane Dowling here is in the Gaelic grounds. And why not after that?
The year is only starting.
I'd say stop dancing, Shane.
Anthony's reminding them there's still a way to go in this championship. Having said that, and for all of these celebrations that are going on here, and for all of what Shane just said about everybody pulling in one direction, will Clare feel very, very hard done by the fact that they did not get quite a straightforward free to level things at the very end?
Yeah, I suppose we have to talk about it, right? It was at the very end. Clare tried to turn the ball over here, Shane O'Donnell, but watch Tony Kelly straight in. Peter Casey, I think it was, got him. And here, even just after this, they win the ball back. Shanahan gives it to Hogan, goes through. William O'Donoghue takes him out high. We have to talk about it. They were two frees they probably should have got. Like, people say, the end of the game, 1 point game, but, you know, that's life, I'm afraid. Dalo will probably speak, but, you know,
it's chaos at the end, though. I mean, the quick puck out should have been allowed to be taken with the pitch invasion, John, clear the fields. Two frees there should have been given. I'm still not whinging about it because we miss so much. You don't deserve to come out on top in a game like that. But still playing heroically and have to learn from this year as opposed to last year.
It's like I'm in House Limerick here. There's like a nightclub going on behind us.
Well, Damien Lawler is about to attempt the impossible and communicate with Limerick manager John Kiely.
John, I guess you'll remember days like this when you're 80, 90. If you get that long, please God you will.
I hope I'll remember them. No doubt they're special, you know. Everyone knew this was going to be just different, you know. And when we arrived today, coming up the Innes Road, we were met by a sea of Clare jerseys and tens of thousands of people from Clare. And, you know, it made the hair stand in the back of your neck. You knew you were heading into something that was going to be very difficult. And it turned out exactly that way. You know, we probably were that little bit better, but we just found it hard to shake them off. You know, they're a very united team. They're a very top quality side. And, you know, they've shown that. In the last number of years, they've been getting better and better with every season. We knew today was going to be a massive, massive challenge. So just thrilled for my boys. I think they showed tremendous resilience. Our bench gave us a huge impact today. I think it was the difference, really, in the finish. Thrilled for Adam English. You know, they've suffered a very difficult 24 hours with his uncle passing away yesterday morning. For him to come on and play as he did, you know, I think he gave a fantastic testament to his uncle, you know. So I'm delighted for him, delighted for the group. Delighted for Paul and all the coaches, Caroline and all the backroom staff. They did a tremendous job in preparing the boys for today, and the boys paid them in spades.
One last question for you. They probably missed maybe two goal chances in the first half. At half time, what did you do to regroup? Because they never got a sniff really until the very end.
Not an awful lot, to be honest with you. You know, we felt at half time our aggression levels and our urgency under the breaking ball was just that bit off, and they were winning the breaking ball, particularly on their own puck out. And we weren't doing well enough on it. I think we rectified that in the second half. Paul identified it and we sorted it. Other than that, you know, we just found more energy, you know. We found more cohesiveness. You know, we probably should have had a few more points on the board, maybe a goal. But listen, just delighted to get the win. It was an incredible victory. And I think, you know, for the boys to have won 5 Munster titles on the trot is a remarkable achievement for this bunch of men, and something that can never be taken from them.
John, 12 finals, 12 wins. Congratulations to you and your players and backroom team. Well done.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you.
Yeah, congratulations to John Kiley. Congratulations to Limerick. Quite possibly not the only piece of silverware that the man beside me is going to be picking up this year after the season he's had. Tom Morrison, congratulations. To win 5 in a row, you keep making this history. Does it just keep feeling as good every time?
Yeah, definitely. You don't have to look at my reaction to see how good it feels. I think if you look out behind us, everyone...
Don't get them started again, Tom!
You know, even you say 5 in a row and you say, does it feel as good every time? I tell you, if you ask anyone, this is very reminiscent of coming back to the Gaelic grounds after 2018, winning our first All-Ireland after 45 years. So, I tell you, we don't get tired of it, and they definitely aren't getting tired of it either.
Certainly not. This man beside you, you broke his heart today, Anthony.
They're breaking my heart regularly now, Joanne, but a team I hugely admire, you know, and keep finding the answers, Tom. Half-time, down a goal, Clare probably doing most of the hurling according to the stats. What's the talk?
Yeah, to be honest, the talk wasn't like, we felt we were going okay, we felt we were going well. You said Clare were doing most of the hurling, I actually felt like we were well in the game, you know, I felt it was 50-50, you know, and it pretty much was, only they got that, I suppose, you know, a fortuitous goal off the upright, and they reacted fastest and they were that goal ahead. But other than that, like, we were just matching them, or they were, like, you know, it was very, very even, but we just, you know, stay relaxed and stay doing what we're doing and, you know, maybe just be a bit more aggressive on breaking ball, and I think we just tidied that up and we got on a bit more possession and we were able to get a few more attacks and a bit more clinical in front of goal then.
Was that the message at half time, to be more aggressive? Because your half back line and your midfielders definitely became more aggressive at the start of the second half and pushed up a little bit more.
Yeah, I think so. You know, I felt we were positioning actually was very well, it was very good, but you know, I think we just left maybe one or two balls, easy possessions, you know, as a player that you'd expect to be gathering and, you know, starting an attack, and we probably just weren't picking up those balls and we were letting them drop, or they were getting a hurley and we just weren't strong enough with our body to make sure that we did get those balls. And, you know, that was pretty much the message, you know. You got to mind the ball and you got to be aggressive and make sure that you do get it, even if it is an easy possession, that you could, I suppose, they were getting a lot of their maybe joy off that. And, you know, we felt if we could just get a foothold in that, you know, that we get a good, I suppose, you know, second half going forward, that would work for us.
Tom, just I referenced there afterwards, Limerick are winning all these games by 1 point or 2 points. It can't be a coincidence. It's not a coincidence. Why is that? Like, what you put it down to, coming down to home straight, there was savage belief inside in that group. Even since I've gone, like, you know, it's gone on to a different level. And all these games, one, two points.
That's why.
Maybe that is the reason.
yeah, do you know? It's probably maybe built over time, Shane. We've been involved in a... DJ's doing a good job today now, we can barely hear.
Spike, is it?
But yeah, you look, we've been involved in a lot of these games throughout the year, Shane, you know yourself. And I think 2018 and everything's kind of bounced since then. You know, you gain confidence, we've been in that situation. As you say, this year alone so many times, but the last 5, 6, 7 years so many times as well. Look, we haven't come out the right side every day. We lost to Clare a few weeks ago by a point here in the Gaelic grounds. We lost Kilkenny in 2019. But yeah, majority of the time, you know, we still remain calm and composed coming down that home stretch. And, you know, we have full belief that what we do will get us over the line.
Good bit of water to still flow under the bridge, Tom.
Sorry?
Good bit of water to still go under the bridge, but could you see a third day in July?
Yeah, sure. Both teams had a very good Munster campaign. Only a point has separated us so far. You know, whoever's going to be in, I suppose, the last four when we're there are going to be four very, very good teams. You know, the Leinster teams will have a big say in this championship as well.
What's happening in Leinster?
Nobody knows that. Talk about Munster, but you know, we've had just last year against Galway and Kilkenny put us right to the, you know, the edge of our collar as well in just last year alone. So, yeah, look, it's been a brilliant championship so far, and I think as a spectator and, you know, as a player, it's just been brilliant to be involved in and brilliant to watch and enjoy.
I don't think that was so much a question as a threat, Tom. Finally, is it more difficult, you think, to get through the Clare defence or that crowd to get back to your teammates?
I say it'll be a tough enough job to get back to my teammates now.
He's never getting back. They are noisy and they are many. Tom Morrissey, thank you so, so much. Celebrations here in Limerick, they are likely to go on for a very, very long time. Tom, and Shane are off to join them while we introduce a Kilkenny man into the mix in studio. Should make for an interesting backdrop for the build-up to our second provincial final, Kilkenny versus Galway, live from Croke Park.